To be of the earth is to know the restlessness of being a seed, the darkness of being planted, the struggle toward the light, the pain of growth into the light, the joy of bursting and bearing fruit, the love of being food for someone, the scattering of your seeds, the decay of the seasons, the mystery of death, and the miracle of birth. And before I begin speaking, I'd like to just invite you to turn to a neighbor and just for a couple minutes share your reflections on this poem and maybe which image, which season seemed to come into focus for you tonight, maybe from this poem. I love working with this poem. We actually opened on Monday, or closed our opening afternoon and evening with this poem. Poems are wonderful for many, many reasons, aren't they? Including the way they offer metaphors for us. In this case, rich metaphors that seem to be so closely attuned to what's really happening all the time. And that allow us to even ask questions implicitly or explicitly, like what season am I in at this point in my life? Am I a seed? Am I bursting and bearing fruit? Am I being food for someone else? Am I feeling particularly the realities of limitation or endings? As adults, sometimes we may feel several seasons in the same day. but metaphorically, this allows us a way in to do some both reflection and sharing. We'll be doing a bit more of this tonight. The theme tonight is leading from within. And I'll be sharing, in particular, some quotes and ideas from a fellow named Parker J. Palmer. How many of you know of Parker or maybe came because you saw his name in the title? Okay. I mean, you're very kind. You could say I saw Rick Jackson's name in the title, but I wouldn't expect you to have come. But it's been my privilege of working with Parker, along with my wife, for about 30 or 35 years in a kind of work that I'll be talking about tonight, but also that I'll be inviting us to experience, just as we have a bit just now. And in particular, I also want to lift up some things that I've learned over the last 20 years or so, in particular, in working in retreats with this approach, and themes about leadership, and in particular, our inner lives as leaders. And when I say leadership, I really want us to hopefully immediately agree that that's all of us. So I'm not just referring to the positional leaders, the elected officials, the executives in firms, but realizing that we all lead in all sorts of ways in our lives, and how we lead and how we show up when we lead matters. I think we all know. So that's kind of the territory that I'd like for us to explore tonight through both some of my remarks and quotes from Parker and a few other folks, but also some of our own conversations with a couple poems along the way. Let me start with another quote that's on your sheet. This first quote by Parker Palmer that's at the top, where he says, "New leadership is needed for new times, but it will not come from finding new and more wily ways to manipulate the external world. It will come as we who lead find the courage to take an inward journey toward both our shadow and our light, a journey that faithfully pursued will take us beyond ourselves to become healers of a wounded world. And a journey of both shadow and light, not unlike that seed spending time in the dark before it pushed through. So courage. Sometimes you could say, well, what do these words have to do with leadership? We sometimes hear metaphors of bravado and kind of standing up on the ramparts. But this inner domain of leadership, or thinking about leadership as an inner journey, will again be our territory for tonight. One way to get into it pretty directly is to acknowledge how frequently, I think it's the case for most of us, when we see a person, maybe for the first time or even on television or in the media, we are implicitly or explicitly asking the question, is this person authentic? Are they real? Are they genuine? You know, are they going through the motions, or is their heart really in the game? Do they really care? And are they reliable and trustworthy? Should I believe her? My guess is you're asking that about me right now, consciously or unconsciously. And I think you can be sure that others ask that of you and of us, that it's one of these meters that's somehow always registering in the back or internally somehow. Although I just used a mechanical metaphor. I'd rather use something else. I think it's an inner quality that we have that's sensing that. Am I safe in this person's presence? Am I willing to trust and open up to a neighbor tonight when this fellow invites me to share already, and we've just come in? So another quote from Parker about this quality, to kind of push this inner dimension or exploration of leadership a little more deeply. He writes, "The power for authentic leadership is not found in external arrangements, but in the human heart." In the human heart. And then some challenging lines. If our institutions are rigid, it's because our hearts, fear change. If they set us in mindless competition with each other, it is because we value victory over all else. If they are heedless of human well-being, it is because something in us is heartless as well. Something in the institutional structures that we've somehow co-created. He goes on to say, our complicity in world-making is a source of awesome and sometimes painful responsibility. A source of profound hope for change as well. It's the ground for our common call to leadership. So part of where I go with this is this challenging thing to at least try to withdraw some of my projections onto them, those people in leadership roles in my organization, in my school, in my hospital, in my neighborhood or community, and remembering that, you know, I'm in this too, not only as another person, as a neighbor, as a colleague, but my psyche, my spirit, my soul is somehow wrapped up in this too. And sometimes my own projections onto others may be perpetuating the very things that I'm wanting to rail against. So that's the territory that I think Parker's inviting us to own and explore. So let me digress for just a little bit and share that about 20 years ago in the mid-90s, my wife Marcy and I came together with Parker to create an organization and to create a programmatic approach to doing work, what we called inner work, around these kinds of issues, things that wouldn't only engage our heads, but really engage our hearts, and realize that, in fact, our hearts need to be engaged in the work that we do, if not only if we're going to be doing it wholeheartedly, but if we're going to be doing good work. And our work initially was with school teachers, public school teachers, from those who work with five-year-olds on up to, in our case, 18 or 19-year-old when students finish high school in the United States. These are people who our society is expecting a lot of by way of not only educating kids, but oftentimes repairing their lives and supporting them in ways through the schools that our society, in fact, doesn't support them, which is why some of those children are struggling in some of the ways that they are. But unfortunately, we don't provide much meaningful support for our school teachers. We frequently will give them every year or two another flavor of ed reform that we think is the latest recipe for fixing everything in the schools that are broken. But rarely do we talk to the teachers in our country about those conditions and invite them to share their ideas as well as what's on their hearts. So when we came together with Parker, our commitment was to create something more than the thin soup of normal professional development, the training approaches that were being given to teachers, and instead to do the very kind of thing that we've already begun to do and we'll do some more of tonight. We created retreats for teachers to come together for 2 or 3 days at a time, to sit in a circle, to utilize poetry. Oh, to go up in flames? Thank you. See, we get by with a little help from our friends. Yeah. Who knows what we would talk about after we started smelling that smoke. So in our groups of maybe 25 teachers, kindergarten through 12th grade, different schools, different school districts, so people can just be there as Mary and John and Pedro, and we're not there because we're all from the same school. And we're all there by invitation. Nobody's sent. We don't believe that people should be sent to do the kind of work that we do, but by choice. And the teachers listen to each other and to sharing their responses, and are asked good questions, like, when did you first think you wanted to be a teacher? What took you into teaching? You know, who's influenced you? And we'd hear about a lot of third grade teachers, or seventh grade teachers, or others, an aunt who teaches, and somebody that they look up to. And we'd hear phrases like, you know, teaching is all I've ever wanted to do. I love being with children. I love what happened to me when I was in a classroom. And then we would ask questions like, when did you first know that you are a teacher? That's who you are. That's your identity. And you're glad for that. And then they would share and listen to each other. And they would also share what was on their heart, what was making it difficult to teach these days. The high-stakes testing, the incessant pressures from outside to be more, as if they didn't care to try to be sufficient to the task. But they could listen to each other, and they could remember why they were in the profession. And over time, maybe the second retreat or the third retreat, we would hear them say things like, I'll be damned if I'm going to be hounded out of this profession that I love and that I know I'm pretty good at. I'm not perfect. didn't ever say I was going to be perfect, but I'm doing my best. And I refuse to check my heart at the door. That kind of comment. Of course, I take my head, but don't we all know, I think, that the best teachers in our lives have been there not only with their heads, but with their hearts, with their fullness, their wholeness. So that was the origin of what we called our Courage to Teach retreats. We utilized the seasons of the year to draw our themes, to do this spiritual work, which is not religious, not explicitly religious, but it is spiritual if we're trying to keep our heads and our hearts connected. So in the fall, we would ask questions like I've just shared, the seeds of your vocation. When did you, how did you step into it? In the winter, we would ask questions and use poetry like, what can we see when it's cold but clear in the winter, as it is in the northern part of the hemisphere? What is it that may be dying in you that needs to be grieved and released so that you can go on? What is it that you are hoping will winter through and you won't lose it, that it hasn't died and that it will be there in the spring to somehow reemerge? So some very thoughtful themes, as you can see. And again, teachers would just dive in and share and be given the time and the space. And we'd usually try to come to a place not unlike Schumacher, where the food was good, it was comfortable and hospitable, and teachers would say things like, tonight it's not cold pizza. But, you know, some they care about us. How kind, how nice, how much we appreciate that. The spring would be largely around themes of paradox. How is it that that which I thought had died is pushing up, like in the poem, pushing up through the mud and the muck and the messy humus of winter, and here it is, you know, daffodils, crocuses. And how is it that we sometimes resurrect in our own lives, our own, after we thought we couldn't do it anymore, we say, you know, I have enough juice to get through to the end of the school year, and happily so. And share stories about how that paradox of what seemed to be dying actually can sometimes come back to life, especially when we can listen to each other around things that matter. And then the summer retreats, same group of 25 teachers, 3 months later, the themes and poems would be around fullness and fecundity and fruitfulness, when the garden is ripe and the zucchinis are large, and when I'm teaching at my best. Teachers too rarely are invited to talk about when they're teaching at their best and share their stories of fruitfulness with their students. But boy, does it matter when they do that, when we do that. So it was both humbling and inspiring to do this work for several years with teachers. And then as we continued, Parker wrote a book called The Courage to Teach, which has become a classic in the field. And thankfully, it's being used more and more in teacher ed. And the bumper sticker, the one-liner from that book, is the phrase, "We teach who we are. We teach who we are." It's back to that theme of authenticity. Is this teacher just phoning it in? Are they just kind of going through the motions? Is this the 17th time they've taught from this outline? Or are they really there to be in relationship? And that's a lot of what Parker writes about in that book, is the difference that being in relationship makes in education. And that good teachers create live encounters, opportunities for real engagement. And we know it. When something's live, the aliveness meter, I say, goes up like this, or when it's just not up. Committee meetings, we know the same thing. Workplaces. So he wrote this book, and as Parker's books do, it sold like this. I mean, there was an initial thing, but Parker's books just kind of keep, they don't trail off. They sell by word of mouth. Have you read this? And so they started to spread beyond education. And so too, we began to get questions from people in other professions. First of all, in medical education, but also in other professions like ministry and ministers and rabbis and imams, religious vocations, community leaders, nonprofit folks, community-based folks, business, other folks saying, we too have read this book called The Courage to Teach, and it speaks to us. And we've heard about this retreat work you're doing with teachers, and we're wondering if there's space for us. Would you ever consider doing some of these retreats for people in my profession? So we said, well, we'll give it a try. And so we began to do retreats with people in other professions, as well as increasingly retreats for people across professions, such as I would guess we are here tonight. We do different things in the community, different professions. And yet, there's some common things that we share, questions that we are interested in across profession. So I would summarize that by saying, you know, our work is really not so much about teaching or being a physician or a minister or a president of a foundation or a company. It's about the person in the profession. It's about how do we show up? Just like those questions I was saying about how as a teacher can I show up? It's how do I show up in the work that I do? And appreciating that really matters around these questions of authenticity, to say nothing of our own ongoing meaning and purpose in life. So that's something of what we do in these retreats, and that's some of what we're doing this week with this circle of folks who've come from near and far, actually, to participate in this approach. And my colleague Barbara Reed is our first Courage and Renewal facilitator here in the UK. We don't really have a strategic plan that looks at the map and puts pins on it. We just try to pay attention to where there's interest expressed and being able to be in conversation with such folks. And that journey began with Barbara a few years ago, and here we are co-facilitating a retreat at Schumacher. So let me push on a little bit more. I'd like to talk about four particular practices that I've observed as being particularly important as I've had the privilege of working with leaders across these professions and folks at different ages, early professional, retirees, everything in between, about what does it mean to be a trustworthy leader? To be a trustworthy leader. A leader within whom others invest trust. Not because they're coerced to do so, but because we find them trustworthy. Well, I'm implying some of the things in response to my first theme in what I've already said, and that is that trustworthy leaders do their inner work, on an ongoing basis. They have practices unique to themselves, and we can talk about what are some of the various practices that we do to continue to do what I would summarize as our inner work, to do that oftentimes difficult, but I think always rewarding work of what is my light, and how is it that projects onto the world, but also how might I be projecting my shadow onto the world. Matter of fact, Parker's definition of leadership in a little essay called Leading from Within is that a leader is a person with the power to project light and shadow on the lives of others and where they dwell. In other words, they have that power, and I think we all have that power, actually, to project both light and shadow, blessing and curse, if you want to strengthen the language even more. My guess is we could brainstorm some leaders who we feel might qualify for the first column some of the time, and for the second column. But I think if we're honest, we'd probably put our names on both columns, at least some of the times, that there are times when we've done things that we're proud of, and there's times that we've done things that we're not so proud of. So this first point is around this responsibility and opportunity we have for doing our own inner work, owning our own shadow, as well as owning our gifts in life. Now we do that in the context of a world, however, in the West in particular, the kind of developed world that elevates rationality, tends to think that that's the coin of the realm, and therefore reason and research and intellectual pursuits, important as they are, and I'm certainly not denigrating them, but they tend to be elevated while emotions are held as suspect. And so it's relatively more rare that we come into a conversation, certainly in a public context, where we might be willing to talk about our inner life, what's going on maybe in that dynamic of light and shadow. And yet I would note that the poem that I began, invited us to begin with tonight, has that imagery right in it of, you know, the time when we're trying to push through the soil, where the seed is, but I think sometimes we are too. And then how wonderful it is to burst forth into the light and offer something. But it's all part of growth, and I think it's all a part of the cycles of being a human being. And don't we also know that sometimes, I know it's been the case for me, some of the most important lessons of my life have been learned from those mistakes, those sometimes shameful and regretted mistakes, but that somehow didn't end my life and others didn't give up on me. But so that's what I mean by inner work, that we value that trustworthy leaders are people that we just have some sense that they're owning that stuff. They're not making themselves too small, nor too big with ego, but they're there to be able to be in an authentic way. In spite of this fact that we live in a culture that thinks that we can think our way out of problems that have been created by too much thinking. I mean, we're just, you know, and you read the paper and studies, back to my comments about education reform, you know, all of these things that are usually coming from a good intended place, but have forgotten to do things like talk to the teachers or talk to the students about what's working. And so it may happen in other settings as well. So I think one of the things that I've learned, I would put this way, there's the hard work, important hard work of rigorous analysis. And there's the harder work of engaging both mind and heart on behalf of something that we might call wholeness. Wouldn't wholeness be made up of both mind and heart? We have both gifts, but we live in a context that oftentimes elevates the one over the other. So the inner work is involving the things that individuals do, and that in our Courage and Renewal retreats, we learn practices of how we can actually do this together. And that, again, is what we've been doing this week. Writing poems about our lives this afternoon, the particularities of our lives, and then sharing them, and finding ourselves feeling quite drawn together. So that's what we do with these various professions, and we hopefully develop the courage. And here I love to remember, as many of you know, because you're closer to France and French, the heart of courage is cœur. Heart. So to have courage is to have heart, but in this holistic sense of heart is the place of integration. Not, this isn't just the place of emotion, head and heart, but heart in the classical sense, isn't it, the place of thinking and feeling and willing and believing all coming together to make a whole person. So some questions that involve and require our wholeheartedness are things like, what are my gifts? What are my gifts, and where are they needed? I think those from my years and years of working with young people in youth work and in college students, I don't know of any more important questions we can be asked. hopefully by some people that are working with us, and teachers and youth workers, that can maybe help us see our gifts or point us to our gifts or mirror, and then point us in some of the directions in the world where they're really needed. Another honest question, who am I becoming in my work? Who am I becoming? Am I becoming more whole? Am I becoming a person I'd like to be with? Or am I actually becoming brittle and harsh and impatient? And if so, how can I recognize that? And how can I become more resilient, flexible? Back to the Courage to Teach program, a quick story. I'll never forget about three retreats into one of these seasonal series, a teacher coming up to me at the end of a session and asking if we could go for a walk, and I said, sure. And we went for a walk, and with tears running down her cheeks, she said, I've just realized today that I have to leave the classroom. My heart's no longer there. And I said, wow. That's a big decision. Sometimes when somebody shares something of that importance, you just try to listen and bear witness. And then she went on to say, and what I'm equally sad about is that I have to leave this program. And I said, why is that? Or who said that? And she said, well, this program is to keep teachers in teaching. And I said, no. No, this program is not to keep teachers and teaching. It's to keep our hearts whole. It's to help us do this kind of work and find the courage to ask these kinds of questions so that if my heart is no longer in the work, then the question is, how can you use this time and space to ask, where is my heart taking me next? What next might my gifts be calling me to, and where might they be useful? Now, it's true, most of the teachers in our Courage to Teach program find renewal and say things like I shared before, I'll be damned if I'm going to be hounded out of a profession that I love. But occasionally a doctor or a minister or a teacher will come to realize I can't do this wholeheartedly anymore. And stop and think about that. You know, the damage that we can do to ourselves by continuing to motor on, pretending that something is true when it isn't, to say nothing of the damage we might do to the students in our classroom or the people in our congregation or the patients that we're seeing in our clinic if we don't really care as much as we know we need to. So that's the importance of inner work. Having the courage to ask those questions with others who want to listen, who are willing to listen. And then our belief, our deep belief really is when we do that, we actually begin to find the courage not only for our own renewal, but for the renewal of our workplace, for the renewal of our profession. And I would hear stories from teachers coming back, not because I would ask them to do this, but coming back and say, you know, I challenged my colleagues last week in our lunchroom because the climate in the lunchroom is toxic because we're just complaining all the time. And I just said, enough. Don't we have more important things to talk about? Because we spend so many hours here and this matters. Well, the profession, the education field has a word for that. They call it teacher leadership. Not teachers leaving the classroom and going to become a principal or a headmaster, but teachers speaking up and saying, this isn't right. We can do better. We can do better with colleagues. Doctors and nurses doing the same things in their hospitals. Becoming citizens, if you will, in their workplace. And again, not because anybody's telling them to, but because they're telling themselves to from something within themselves. Because of the time, I want to point you to another poem and read it and pause there, but we won't take quite as much time as I was anticipating before. But there's a poem by the American poet, died in 1989, William Stafford, called The Way It Is. The Way It Is. And hopefully, as I read it, it may both resonate with you in a certain way, and you may also have some glimpses because of what I've been sharing as to why it's become a kind of a core poem in our Courage and Renewal work for helping us do this kind of inner work. The Way It Is. He wrote this, I will add, at age 79, weeks before he died. And yet this image, this metaphor of a thread that is in the poem is one that he thought of as a young adult in college. And he just continued to hold this question of what if there's some kind of wispy thing that I'm trying to follow in life? Not even as real as a real filament of fiber, but that's the metaphor. So a few weeks before he dies, William Stafford writes this poem, The Way It Is. There's a thread you follow. It goes among things that change, but it doesn't change. People wonder about what things you are pursuing. You have to explain about the thread, but it's hard for others to see. While you hold it, you can't get lost. Tragedies happen. People get hurt or die, and you suffer and grow old. Nothing you do can stop time's unfolding. You don't ever let go of the thread. So we can see how many questions are embedded in this simple and yet profound poem. What threads am I following? What themes have been there from maybe as long back as I can remember as a child, or maybe things became clear when I was a young adult, or maybe certain things are just getting a little clearer now, or maybe things aren't clear at all, but there's certain questions that just I continue to be intrigued by. Whatever forms those threads may take, I think that's what he's pointing us to. And another thing that I know I love about this poem myself is it's one of these poems that kind of, in a glimpse, allow us to look at life in its entirety, the whole arc of life, from early to middle to late, while tragedies happen, while life unfolds, while we accomplish things, while we suffer our disappointments. But that this sense, this human sense that we're trying to have some kind of through line, some kind of continuity of meaning and values, and that we can talk about those things with each other. And by talking and listening to each other, we can help each other maybe discover not only those threads, but why they're important. So a second practice, a very specific practice in our retreats, that I believe, especially in working with a lot of leaders in our retreats from various professions, trustworthy leaders practice. And that is, trustworthy leaders learn to ask open and honest questions and then listen. They value listening. I value your listening right now and your attentiveness. Again, our dominant culture and acculturation in schools and workplaces is oftentimes one that values asking questions, but particular kinds of questions. typically analytical questions, diagnostic questions, questions that move us in a strategic direction. And such questions are neither wrong nor unimportant, but they can be limiting, in fact. Whereas open, honest questions are questions that we can learn to ask that actually help another person hear themselves into deeper and deeper speech. Hear themselves into deeper speech because of our listening, because of our paying attention at deeper and deeper levels. That might lead me to ask another question that might lead them to respond from a deeper place. Parker is a Quaker, and the Quakers have a discernment process called the Clearness Committee. The Quakers, as you may know, don't have priests and ministers. They have each other, and they sit in meeting with each other, and they welcome silence. And they have a variety of meetings. They have meetings for worship, and they have meetings for business, and they have meetings for learning. And they have meetings for memorial, to remember persons when they die. And they sit quietly. And they have this process called the Clearness Committee, meetings for discernment around important things. And the way, and we'll be doing this practice tomorrow with our circle here this week. And in a nutshell, it involves sitting. Let's say I'm the person with a question seeking discernment, sitting with four or five other people who agree to sit with me for 2 hours and interact with me in one way, and that is to ask me open, honest questions. And I'm invited to interact within myself to reach deeper and deeper for my responses to those questions. As a focused person, I may be invited to close my eyes or do whatever I need to do to stay within myself. So it's as if the questions just come from the universe. Fixing, advising, correcting are forbidden. Have you read this book? That's not an open, honest question. Have you thought about seeing a therapist? That's not an open, honest question. That's advice in the form of a question. How long has this awareness been with you? Have there been other experiences in your life that might inform what you're facing now? Those are open questions. So you see the difference. Open questions can invite us to explore the territory of our own lives. And they can invite us to discover the resourcefulness of our own lives, something that the Quakers believe deeply in, this inner teacher, this inner light, that when it comes to life's most important questions, the most important advice lies within us. It may be buried a bit, which is why people asking us questions patiently can be very helpful. So that is another practice that is a centerpiece of our way of being together, that we really observe, that I observe, contributes to trustworthy leadership when I can be better at that. And again, let me remind us all, I just thought of myself, how when I have been able to remember with my two daughters, as they've been growing up and as they're adults now, to resist my compulsion to give advice, it's not easy at times, but in fact, instead to think, what question might I ask that might open things up a bit for Louisa as well as maybe for me? Conversation goes in a whole different direction. And I'm sure we all have those experiences, and I would trust we all have such friends who are able to sit with us that way. The difference, just to name it for us, and Gandhi named this difference, and I think a very helpful way in his writing and teaching. Again, the world asks us to become more and more effective at being instrumental, kind of strategic, getting an intended outcome, a measurable result. And those things, again, are not unimportant. But when we get too wed to achieving measurable results, a couple things can happen, especially in an organizational context. If the stakes are high, as we've created them in education these days, public schools in the States, what sometimes happens is to assure measurable results, the bar gets lowered. Because after all, I've been asked to get measurable results and I need to exceed the goal. So one way of doing that is to lower the goal. Now that doesn't necessarily equate to quality education for a child, but it happens. Or you've maybe read other things where administrators will go in and correct the tests for the kids so that when they get scored, the test results for their school are higher. I mean, crazy things. But that's what happens when we get too wed to instrumental means as if that's the most important thing. Another thing that can happen, though, is we've all heard the phrase, the best laid plans. On our way to implementing this strategy, life happens. And if we don't continue to take into consideration the continuing emergence of life, we can end up with tragic results. We can look at geopolitics. I don't think the United States really intended to have happen in Vietnam what happened, or Iraq. And yet, you get on a rail, and ego comes in, et cetera, and those things can happen. So Gandhi's critique of that is to call that instrumental thinking, which again is useful for some things, but he accompanies that with valuing expressive action. So not only instrumental actions, but expressive actions. What are expressive actions? Expressive actions are things that we can't do by using only our heads. They're expressions of our values. They flow up from our convictions and our spirit. It would be that holistic, authentic showing up with as much of ourselves as we can. Expressive acts are the courageous, sometimes lonely, actions we take to be true to ourselves as best we can. And they require courage sometimes because not only may they be solitary, but there are those times when we may be feeling called to speak truth to power in whatever ways that may be playing out. When a teenager speaks to mom or dad in a way that just says, I've got to take a stand here, or in public life. When we speak expressively, we may gain or lose a friend. We may gain or lose a job. There's people in history who may have lost their freedom. Nelson Mandela, Vaclav Havel, Rosa Parks in the United States. And yet, we revere these people historically because that wasn't the end of the story, was it? They ultimately regained a greater freedom, not only for themselves, but actually for us all, through that courage to speak expressively. During the 27 years in Robben Island, Nelson Mandela can't have known he was going to get out at a certain point. His freedom to make either very many expressive or instrumental acts, certainly instrumental acts, was removed. And yet he was doing something within himself, within his heart and soul, we might call that inner work, that allowed him to emerge and not only remain in the prison of his own resentment after leaving the prison cell, but go on to lead his nation and refuse to perpetuate a kind of racism that had always been his burden before prison and during prison. So these, you know, I think we revere these historical figures, such as those three individuals I named, and we could name others, for those reasons. But Gandhi would be another, but partly because he's creating an important distinction for us, isn't he, between only dwelling in the instrumental world of newspaper headlines and Dow Jones stock market reports, etc., but also remembering that we have this freedom of expressing ourselves from the heart. And how do we know when we're doing that? I think one way is when we know that we're alive in our own skin, when we can breathe in and breathe out and say, that was my breath, without enormous anxiousness, but a sense that I'm, again, that teacher that said, I'm not perfect, but I know I'm in the profession that I'm meant to be in, and I'm doing the best I can. I've shared with some of my colleagues in the circle, my younger daughter Louise is in her sixth year as a kindergarten teacher, and I go there every month to spend some time in her classroom, and I just marvel at her gifts. She was kind of a magical child, which is maybe partly how she first resistance and then went into teaching young children and dancing with their expressiveness, even as she's getting important things done with math and reading and all that. So another thing, a third practice that trustworthy leaders learn to do, and none of these you'll be noting are particularly walks in the park. They're not easy, but I think they are important. Trustworthy leaders learn to hold tension between reality and possibility, between current realities that in many cases may be quite tragic and actual possibility because they've maybe seen it. So we're not talking about pie in the sky, idealized at elevation, you know, airy-fairy dreams. This is something that Parker writes about as learning to live and lead and stand in the tragic gap, the gap between current reality and hoped-for possibility. It's the gap that Rosa Parks, shall we say, sat in when she sat on the front of the bus and was told, you have to go to the back of the bus, this isn't your place, and if you don't move, we will have to arrest you. And she said, you may do that. You may do that. As if to say, you know, your prison pales by comparison to the prison I've kept myself in by diminishing myself by obeying your unjust laws. So she sat down, or she stood up in that narrow place of possibility that actually became a fulcrum, a pivot point in our U.S. civil rights history. We all know these gaps. My work for many years was in youth work in the YMCA, and I was a real champion for particularly youth leadership programs. I don't know in your cultures, but a phrase commonly said in the U.S. is youth are our future. But most of the youth I would have the privilege of being with and college students were not interested in being anybody's future. They wanted to be leading now. They wanted to be working on things that they cared about now. Plus, how better to be to be a leader in the future than to be a leader now? And my guess is many of us had such experiences growing up that have led us to be doing the things that we're doing now or questing. but a gap that I stood in was, on the one hand, I saw how effective those programs were in achieving important things in the community, and getting trees planted and all sorts of things when we'd roll up our sleeves. But the funding in the programs for youth was mostly for what we would sometimes shorthand as rotten outcomes. Most of the budgets went for kids that dropped out of school, you know, drug and alcohol, teenage pregnancy, homelessness, really important things, but also incredibly expensive and preventable. Not purely, but you know, positive activities. As a police chief said once, we've got too many kids who are all dressed up with no place to go, no good place to go. So one of the gaps I had to live in was this knowledge of what works, and yet watching the dollars go over here very expensively to imprisonment and interventions and all these things. You may have equivalents in your communities. So that was a gap that I had to live in, and then I found that, okay, I need to speak from that and speak about the possibility for other approaches to youth development that really can work, even while addressing these very real issues was also important. So let me just, this quote is also on your sheet, quote Parker again in this regard, making real progress on real life issues requires us to hold perhaps the most subtle and yet the most difficult tension of all, the tension between reality and possibility. He says, I've come to think of this as this holding of this tension as standing in the tragic gap, the gap between our knowledge of what is and our knowledge of what might be. If we find ourselves unable to stand in that place, we will be pulled to one side or another toward the paralyzing cynicism that too much reality can breed, or toward the irrelevant idealism that is bred of too much possibility. Now, what does that last line mean? I know if I'm not careful, I can read too many newspapers, I can spend too much time online about who's bombing whom and what, you know, and pretty soon I can get crispy and cynical and, you know, it's possible. Or another version of cynicism is when we just live in our own comfortable envelope or enclave and said, I got mine. Well, that's kind of to take me out of the game, isn't it? But so too, this language, I guess he didn't use the phrase in this quote, but I've heard Parker call this, it is there, irrelevant idealism. And I remember when I first heard him say that, I went, ooh. Because I think I am one at times, or I have been one at times, probably still am, because I like to be an idealist, or I like to be working for the new possibility and the progressive cause, etc. But here too, he's saying, yeah, but if that's at elevation, if that's not grounded in actual, you know, roll up my sleeve work, it's really not on the ground of reality, and it's maybe no better than the cynicism. They both move us into ditches. So to foster meaningful change is to find that place and to know that it may be slow going, especially if we are determined to work on things that matter, like civil rights, like environmental preservation and global warming and justice, economic equality. I mean, these things are not going to be accomplished in any of our lifetimes, are they? Does that mean that we should give up on them? I don't think so. It means we need to find a way to find a place to take our stand and do our work and make our contribution and support yours and yours and yours, and create those intergenerational partnerships that may be required. So standing in this gap requires both courage and humility, which when we think about it, courage and humility, we could think of as a paradox. Sometimes we think of those as opposites. But to do that, we must remember both inner and outer realities to stand in difficult places. We must remember that both continuity and change are important for any meaningful progress. Some things we need to stay in there with, and some things need to die and let go of. And both the ground for current reality and hopeful vision can motivate us. So we do a lot of work with paradox in our circles, the vital both-andedness of life, where opposites that are both distinctively true are nevertheless still both true, like the most immediate one that's happening in this room right now is we're both breathing in and we're both breathing out. So it would be rather silly of me, wouldn't it, to say which is more important, breathing in or breathing out. We could all do an experiment on that right now. It's this side of the room, breathe in, and this side of the room, breathe out, and then we'll see. I mean, it's silly. But we, again, in our dominant culture, we're constantly saying in our news the favorite current question of the commentator with the microphone in somebody's face is, after they've described some horrible situation, they'll say, well, is this a good thing or a bad thing? And rarely, if ever, do we find a leader thoughtful enough or mindful enough to be able to say, well, if you'll give me a moment, I will describe how this is both a good thing and a bad thing. Right? Let's look for that. So that's what it means to be in this gap, is to be able to hold paradox, individuality. Here's a few more examples that I think are so important for us right now. We, especially in the West, live with the benefits of individuality, the rugged individual, etc. Yet what's needed now most is a fresh understanding of caring and community and the common good, that we're, in fact, all in this together. That's a paradox. I don't think we want to give up our individual freedoms, and yet we must cultivate these other qualities, and I think our hearts yearn. And Schumacher College is so much, and this community of Totness is so much about rethinking those realities. Another, we've developed more and more ways to exploit nature's bounty for human gain. And we benefit from that in many, many ways. And yet, what's needed now is a greater humility and appreciation for our place within the web of life. And you don't need me to come here to tell you how profoundly you are all about that. And another obvious one, with wondrous technologies playing a larger and larger role in our lives, our iPhones and pads and internet, we must recognize that we also need to develop a greater appreciation for the limits of technology, for the limits. That technology may not, in fact, be the answer to everything that ails us, the next invention. And that, frankly, as a tool-making species, we humans, we have to recognize that we aren't doing so well on learning the lesson that inventing and using inventions are not the same thing. So we have this thing that we call this technological imperative, that somehow because we can imagine it and create it, we should use it. We may or may not survive as a species if we don't learn that lesson. So these are some of the examples of the gaps that maybe I'm naming some of the ones that you're choosing to live in and work in. And let me close with the fourth one, and then my, you've been patient with me. I've been talking longer than I intended tonight. But the fourth practice that Parker names that we really again, seek to not only lift up, but practice in our circles, is this paradox of both affirming that we are all in this together and develop an appreciation for what we may call otherness or diversity, that we're also very particular. And the poems that we wrote this afternoon in our circle evolved from an awareness of our particularity and a memory, inviting ourselves to remember how we grew up in very specific places with very particular people and memories and smells and tastes and foods and all. And the poems that emerged from that were just extraordinary. So how can we come together to celebrate our otherness, our richness, and in doing so, that actually helps us feel more deeply connected. Another paradox. So those four practices, doing our inner work, learning to listen, particularly in response to our open questions, holding tension between current reality and hoped for possibilities, and affirming that we're all in it together while also celebrating and appreciating our distinctiveness, our otherness. Those are things that I think I've been observing and experiencing that when they're present, I relax and I engage with others in their leadership. And when I'm able to behave that way, I think I observe others engaging with me. And we might call that trustworthy, authentic leadership. I'd like to close with one more poem. It's the last poem on the back side of your sheet. And then there'll be, maybe we should just call that a break so that those of you who want to leave or need to leave, please feel free to do so. And others who'd like to stay for a little bit of further conversation or questions, feel free to do that. But I want to use a word that maybe I mentioned in passing, but I want to be very specific to include it before we close. And it's a word in Mary Oliver's poem. And that word is love. I think leaders that I come to trust not only are somewhat clear about what they love, but they're at least occasionally willing to talk about it. Maybe not in using that word, but a teacher that, you know, will talk about her love of her students, his love of his profession. And we realize that this too is a paradox, because anything that is truly worthy of love will break our hearts. It's almost guaranteed. Because we care. We come to care deeply for those students, for that patient, that we've done so much to do to help them heal, and we know they're dying. And there's only so much we can do. And we have to recognize that limit, and yet maybe not give up on our efforts to be a healer. We all have those experiences. We all have those things that we care deeply about. So then the question, and again, we have Parker to thank for this lovely language, is what do we do with that heartache or that heartbreak? Do we become cynical? Do we distance ourselves from things that we love, or because I don't want to get hurt anymore? That's one kind of heartbreak, and we all know it from our own experience, what we might describe as when our heart shatters into a million pieces, and it feels like we'll never put it together again. Young love can be that way, I know. But it can happen, that sense of devastation and desolation. But Parker also describes another possibility, and that is that when our hearts break, and every religious tradition has language about this, they can also grow. They can break open so that they hold more of life. No guarantee. It's not an instrumental act. It's an expressive act. And we've been with people, and we may be people, who've endured terrible things, very difficult things, and yet somehow emerged over time with something more to offer. So that quality, I think, also gradually emerges in authentic leaders, and authentic and trustworthy leaders. And again, I'm saying leader not to say those people out there, but all of us. And so can those qualities emerge in poets. And so we'll close with this poem by Mary Oliver called Lead. And I will tell you now that she writes about a particular species of bird that I don't know if you have it in your country here in the UK or in Spain, called the loon, the common loon. It makes a hauntingly beautiful sound. It's found actually up in northern Minnesota and in Canada, in the boundary waters, in these protected waters. And I'll try to risk. It's a plaintive, ooh, ooh. You'll hear it in the morning, and you'll hear it at dusk. It's just piercingly beautiful. And they dive deep into the water to get the fish, and then they come up. You probably have some species that do similar things or maybe related to the loon. That's the bird she's writing about in this story that I'm inviting us to hear, not only through the voice of a poet, but through the voice of a leader. Lead. Here is a story to break your heart. This winter, the loons came to our harbor and died, one by one, of nothing we could see. A friend told me of one on the shore that lifted its head and opened the elegant beak and cried out in the long, sweet savoring of its life, which, if you have heard it, you know is a sacred thing, and for which, if you have not heard it, you had better hurry to where they still sing. And believe me, tell no one just where that is. The next morning, this loon, speckled and iridescent, and with a plan to fly home to some hidden lake, was dead on the shore. I tell you this to break your heart. By which I mean only that it break open and never close again to the rest of the world. The power for authentic leadership is found not in external relationships, but in the human heart.